Hi, this is an overview of your accounting theory from your mid-year exam. I've restructured some of the questions to reflect the structure on the end-of-year exam, which is reflected in the exam specs that I'll show you now, which are here. You'll notice here that's the task site. At the bottom here, exam assessment specifications. And I'm looking at financial knowledge here, obviously assessors criterion 1. These elements relate to parts of the syllabus standards, but what I wanted to show you is at the bottom here, the sample example questions only. So part A talks about accounting terms and concepts and principles and so on relating to recording and controlling. The second one talks about making financial decisions. The third part of question one looks at distinguishing and contrasting and related but contrasting terms. And question two is solely related to accounting assumptions and qualitative characteristics. So what I've done is put that into a series of questions that I'm going to talk to you through now. So question 1A, I've referred you to it. This is the accounting terms relating to recording, controlling and managing the risk information of a business, and that is the website I showed you. So here's a series of questions. I'm going to explain them how and pointing out things that you should have mentioned in your answer. So bank reconciliation is part of your cash control, and importantly it reconciles the business records of the bank statements, and you do that by identifying a number of differences, and that's reflected in the process that you have to undertake to create a bank reconciliation. You have to find unrepresented checks, because if you don't, then the bank statement won't agree with your cash at bank account balance. Similarly with deposits not yet credited into the bank statement, and also there's items that are credited in the bank account and debit in the bank account that are not actually in our record. So we must enter those in our cash journals before we make any reconciliations. It's there also to identify errors in the bank or in the from the business perspective, and they need to be adjusted. Remember that errors from the bank get adjusted on the bank reconciliation statement, and from the business they get adjusted in the cash journals. We also have to identify and reverse any dishonored checks. They're checks that have been paid to us that have not had the funds in the account, and therefore they need reversing and adjusting in our own cash records. Reversal entries. They're done to correct errors that we as in the business have done in relation to posting into ledger accounts. So in order to fix those, we must first of all reverse that mistake and to re-enter the correct transaction. Sometimes we can just make an adjusting entry. That's also valid, but generally this is the correct way of doing it, and especially when you talk about the theory, this is what you need to do. Now, reversing entries are nothing like reversal entries, and they relate to balance day adjustments, and they're made one day after in order to close the temporary asset and liability accounts like prepaid expense and accrued expense and so forth that were prepared on balance day. So these accounts only appear for one day. And they also reverse the revenue expense accounts that we initially adjusted, and they must be returned to their initial state before the balance day, because if we don't do that, then those respective accounts will be under or overstated and counted twice. Intangible assets are part of a non-current asset. It's important to state that, and they are in the intangible section of our balance sheet and under non-current assets. They are not physical but have a value. An example here, goodwill patents, there's a spelling mistake there, I'm sorry, and copyrights. So the things of value that the business has purchased or recognized at some point which are then put in the as a non-current asset in the balance sheet. Balance day adjustments. Also, I forgot to mention that with all these, I've included page references to your textbook, The Accounting Concepts and Applications by Greg Mackay, Beaumont and Sagner. These are general journal entries made on balance day to match the revenues expenses in the correct accounting period. That's really important. There's four types: accrued expenses, accrued revenues, prepaid expenses and unearned revenues. Sometimes also called prepaid revenues. So these are done on balance day in order to make sure that the correct expenses and revenues go in the right accounting period. Chart of accounts. This allocates in a unique number to each ledger account that's in your general ledger. We normally use a numbering system. This is an example, you don't have to do it like this. But all the revenues start with 1 or 1,000s, the expenses with 2,000s or 100s, whatever the case may be, whatever you want. They're there to easily reference accounts in the future, but also to keep our ledger orderly and organised. Inventory adjustment, that's made to adjust any discrepancies between the number of units on hand to the number recorded in our actual records. We establish this information usually from a stock take, which is, tends to be laborious but essential and must be carried out each time we want to calculate a profit. The general journal entry to adjust that, if we have a loss, that means we've lost some, that's common, some have been stolen or deteriorated or it's plainly lost. We must debit inventory adjustment, which is an expense, and we credit inventory to record the reduced value of inventory. Sometimes we have a gain, sometimes orders that we receive from our suppliers may not be correct and therefore end up with extras, or sometimes our recording in terms of taking inventories out that have been sold or whatever the case may be have not been recorded properly, therefore we have this thing called an inventory gain and that's classified as a other operating revenue. Source documents is a document to take account of a transaction occurring. It's like a, or it is a contract, and therefore there must be two documents, one for the person that writes it and the customer that that gets the that's other part of the transaction. It describes the transaction, the date, the amount, and usually has some sort of signature or person authorized to make that authorization or to make that payment. As I said, there's usually one copy for the business and one copy for the customer. And they can be either be electronic or on paper, but these days more is done on electronically. And it's a basis to enter all our transactions in their into our journals. Now, you've been taught only to use general journals, and that's what we use. But there are cash journals and credit journals. The source documents are usually numbered. And here are the different types. So these two here are the cash items when we generate a payment, and that these days is often done electronically. When we, and same with the receipt, when we receive cash. When we generate a tax invoice, that's part of our credit transactions. And when that credit transaction needs an adjustment, for example, a sale return, then that must be also acknowledged with an adjustment note, which is opposite to a tax invoice. To trial balance, there's also some errors with it, or how we identify errors. So firstly, the list of all balances on all active ledger accounts in our general ledger. Every account either has a debit or a credit balance, and these are then listed onto a list, which is called a trial balance. We do this procedure generally before we prepare our financial reports, our income statement and balance sheet. All these entries should, or the balance, or the balance I should have here, the balance should equal if the accounting process has been completed correctly. And if you haven't, then you have not completed your debits and credits correctly, and therefore you must find the mistake. However, errors still can occur in these number of instances. Suppose that both entries have been entered on the wrong side. So that means that you've got double the mistake, but nevertheless, the trial balance will still balance. What about if you have totally omitted an entry? It's still going to balance. You could have entered it twice, or you can indeed enter the incorrect amount. So if you've done it evenly, then the trial balance will still balance, but it won't be correct. And you'll find this the case when you do your exercises. So that's a series of questions that could be asked. It's not comprehensive, of course, but they're the ones that I wanted to give you feedback on based on a mid-year exam. In question 1B, it relates to accounting terms making financial decisions, and you have to provide examples as well. Here I've got a question which we haven't yet covered, but I'll put it in there just to give an indication. So you can use this for the end of year revision if you like. So limitations of producing financial statements. You would already know this, that some values like depreciation, doubtful debts are estimates, and therefore they're not going to be correct, and therefore the valuations can be out. Some assets are valued at conservative estimates, for example, accounts receivable and plant equipment, so they're net of depreciation and doubtful debts, or provision for doubtful debts in relation to accounts receivable. So they've been marked down, if you like, at lower values, and they're based on estimates, which obviously can be incorrect. Assets are valued at historical cost, that's according to the historical cost assumption, and not the current cost. Therefore, investments and property values cannot reflect the current market value. Intangible assets such as goodwill and patents, again, it's an estimate, and can be incorrectly valued, especially if in relation to goodwill, if a business is purchased, an existing business, and goodwill is included in the purchase price, then if the business is not managed very well, then the value of goodwill will go down quickly and therefore won't be a accurate reflection of the total value of the assets of the business. When we talking about sources of finance, it's a very important part of any business. we've got three choices. The first one, debt financing. So that'll increase our liabilities, increases the risk, we'll always have to pay interest, and also dependent on the term of the loan. And this can make the business less stable. It certainly increases the chance of profit, but it can make it more instable, especially if interest rates go up or if the economy changes. So we can use equity financing. That's where we ask existing owners to contribute more money, or indeed we can increase the number of owners to the business. So that means it is less risky, but it reduces the control of the current owners. So they have to obviously, if there's more people that own the business, and they have to be accountable to them as well. Another way of reducing cash flow is to lease assets rather than pay for them outright. The downside of that is that you have to pay interest. Obviously, it's going to be more expensive over time, but the upside is that we reduce the cash flow in the short term. So in question 1C, you're distinguishing and contrasting related terms, principles and ideas. So that can come from any of those areas that I've just previously mentioned, and here are some examples. What are the two types of non-financial information when making business decisions? Well, we don't know what type of industry this business operates in and what is actually sold. What section of the market is it in? Economic information is not included. For example, what about if interest rates go up or down? KPIs, key performance indicators, are not given. They may form part of the business objectives. For example, staff turnover and sales targets. They're not necessarily reflected, or they're non-financial information. That by that it means it's not included into financial statements. Is it a big business in its market? So therefore, market share, market size also are non-financial information that comes into play. So if the market share is smaller, then the ability to affect the prices is less, and therefore, if a bigger player comes to the market, then competition will be another issue that might impact that business. The difference between accrual and cash accounting is on page 154. Accrual accounting recognises transaction when revenues are earned and expenses incurred, okay, not when they are received or paid, and that's what cash accounting is all about. Now, there's two other principles here. Accounting recognition talks about that is in support of accrual accounting, which recognises when revenues are earned, and realisation in cash is to do when cash actually changes hands. So if I realise something, it's not something I realise in terms of idea. In accounting, it means that we have either sold or bought an asset, and the realisation is the cash that's involved in the transfer of goods or services or an asset. This is subsidiary ledgers and control accounts. Now, subsidiary ledgers are additional ledgers that hold individual information. For example, we've got a whole lot of accounts receivable and accounts payable accounts. Now, that information this is contrasted to what we call a control account that is in the general ledger, and that has the total of all the accounts payable, and the subsidiary ledgers has all the individual accounts that we owe money to, and the same with accounts receivable. It removes the clutter from the general ledger and gives us more control. The difference between the provision for doubtful debts and the bad debts expense. When a debtor, or one of our accounts receivable control customers, goes bankrupt, the debt owed to the business is totally extinguished. Therefore, we recognise it as a bad debt. So then we've got this thing called bad debts expense. Now, we're in a position where, if we're realistic about it, over a period of time, usually a year, we expect some of our debts to go bad. So therefore, some of them are doubtful. So they're unlikely to be collected, but they haven't yet been declared bad. So they're doubtful at this stage, which means we must make a provision, which we do at the balance day, to recognise the likelihood of some debts being doubtful. But this reduces the value of accounts receivable, which adheres to the conservative principle. And what this does, it also attempts to match the potential doubtful debts expense against the revenue from the relevant accounting period. So if we don't do that, we're not adhering to the matching principle in relation to managing our debts. The difference between capital and revenue expenditure is an issue when we buy non-current assets. So if we buy a non-current asset, we've got to work out what part of that expenditure is capitalised, and that part is depreciated. So it involves any cost to improve the asset or increase the life of the asset, and the cost to bring it into operation. So examples would be, if I buy a car, then obviously the car, if I improve it and put a tow bar on it, or if I put a bigger motor into it, and also if I have to pay any freight costs in order to get the car into operation in my business. So they're all part of what the costs that we capitalise, and therefore that forms part of what we must depreciate over time. Now, this is contrasted against revenue expenditures, that expenses to maintain and operate non-current assets during its useful life. For example, for the car, I have to register it, insure it, maintain it, Put petrol in it. And it's important that we make this distinction because revenue expenditures are taken away straight away against the net profit, whereas capital expenditures, they're capitalised and recognised in the balance sheet as a non-current asset, from which we then have to calculate depreciation, which then comes off in increments over the useful life of the assets. It comes off against a profit over time. Balance day adjustments and the matching principle is a very important distinction to make. Balance day adjustments are made on balance day to match the correct expenses and to the related revenues that they relate to. It gives a better reflection of what happened in terms of the profit, and that's why we do it. It's an important distinction between profit and cash. Now, as you know, profit is when we take expenses away from revenues. Now, business can make profit but still have cash flow problems, and that is due to the fact that cash can also be used to pay drawings, pay back loans, and pay for non-current assets. So, these three things reduces cash flow in addition to paying for expenses. So that's why a business can make profits, or reasonable profits, but still have cash flow problems because of these things. The distinction between internal and external users. Internal users, managers, employees, and owners, they use financial information, so that's two L's there, I'm sorry, to operate and manage the business. Whereas external users make interpretations about the business in their dealings with the business. For example, the Australian Tax Office, I want to know how much income or net income that they've generated, so they have to pay the tax. The bank, they want to know what's the financial stability and ability to repay repayments when they are wanting to extend a loan to banks. Future investors want to know how profitable and how much the business may grow in the future, so they want to know some information. And sometimes trade unions use financial information for wage demands. In question 2A, it totally looks at assumptions and qualitative characteristics in the preparation of accounting reports. So in the first part, in part A, you will get a whole range of questions about the accounting assumptions. The important thing to realise about the accounting entity assumption that we look at separate entities, so personal items should be kept separate from business items and should be treated as drawings if a personal check is made on behalf of the owner. Should be treated as drawings. The accounting period assumption is where we arbitrarily allocate profit to time periods. So the one that we normally use is the 1st of July to the 30th of June. So it's an arbitrary time period chosen in order so we can calculate our profit. You must always talk about the matching principle because this is there to match revenues with the relevant revenue in the correct accounting period. And also relates, and that's the reason why we make balance day adjustments. So you could include a comment about that as well. The monetary assumption is fairly straightforward. You must use Australian dollars and not litres or anything like that. The historical cost assumption uses the cost of time of purchase. And we do this because we want to have more reliable information in our balance sheet. The going concern assumption assumes that the business will continue to operate in the future and not to stop at any time soon, and that is not the reason why we value our assets, liabilities and owner's equity in our balance sheet. Now there's some qualitative characteristics as well. So in relation to selection of financial information, we've got relevance. Assists the user in decision-making, make decisions about financial resources. It also reflects accountability by preparers of financial information. So it's got to be obviously relevant. It's got to be reliable. So it must be free of bias and undue errors. And the information that is presented must make a material difference. So if it's a really small item, then there's a case to be had that it doesn't necessarily need to be reported separately. And the question is whether reporting that information will affect the decision making of the business, whether by internal users or external users. In relation to presentation of financial information, we must have information that is the same from one accounting period to the next, so we can compare it. So the comparability qualitative characteristics important, and also we want to sometimes compare different businesses over time. So if they're using the same accounting principles and using the same accounting periods and so on and so forth, we can make better comparisons and better judgments. Understandability is fairly straightforward. Any information in the report should assist users in understanding any information that is presented. And it also must be timely, so therefore the report should be reported in a timely manner. So that means that if you're 1 or 2 years late, or even a month late, depending on what type of business you run, it becomes out of date and irrelevant. Most businesses who are keen about keeping track of their profits certainly report their profits on a monthly basis. So if there's any things that go wrong or trends that occur, then they can be corrected quickly rather than having to wait to the end of the year, or indeed if you wait longer, then you don't know what to base your decisions from. So timeliness is very important. In question 2B, you get given a whole range of case studies, and then you have to say, well, what's wrong here? And then to say what should happen and why. So you should say why it's breached, the likely implication of that breach, for example, if it impacts upon profit or valuation or the operation of the business, and then sort of say, well, we have to say what to do correctly. Let's look at some case studies. So state the assumption, describe the impact, and state what should have happened. And if you possibly can, relate a qualitative characteristic to the answer, even if it talks about a assumption. Let's look at some examples. Here's a business owner that's purchased some life insurance for himself, then records as an expense in the business. Now what you should have included here is that it's breached the accounting entity assumption. It reduces the profit, and it should be treated as a separate entity. So therefore, this particular expense should not be treated as an expense, but treated as drawings. And another issue here, that this family expense, if you like, is not relevant to the business. Therefore, we shouldn't include it. Another question. This is a silly one, but it comes up in exams. Come up now, mid-year exam. So the stock of petrol in litres, what you should have done is to use a monetary assumption, which means we use Australian dollars. It has an impact in increasing the profit figure and undervaluing the stock. And doing something like that doesn't give reliable figures, and how relevant is it not to record your petrol in dollars rather than litres. Another question, they decide to revalue their assets in light of inflation, or that sounds rather sensible, but it breaches the historical cost assumption, gives an incorrect valuation, and the historical cost assumption should be valued at cost when it was purchased, and the reason why that is the case because it's more reliable, because otherwise you'd be relying on estimates or market valuations, which are not necessarily correct, even if you value it at the time that you do it. Here's another question. They received payment in advance, but they haven't included in the current year revenue, so it hasn't been recognised. So the accounting period assumption has been breached, so the profit would be out in both accounting periods, so it's under in one and over in another. We should match the revenues with expenses in the correct accounting period. So please remember, whenever you talk about the accounting period, also mention the matching. It's important to do that to get full marks. And how can we compare one period to the next, an inflated profit and an underreported profit in the next? Here's another question. They purchased equipment 2 years ago, they used a straight line, and they changed over to the diminishing balance method for this year. So this is the consistency assumption. The incorrect profit would be recorded in both accounting periods. We should use the same accounting method or valuation method in order to have better comparability from one period to the next. So I hope that's been useful to you. I can make another one of these videos perhaps to reflect other questions, but this is direct feedback in relation to your mid-year exams.